closing costs for sellers. Can you negotiate closing costs? That's our topic today. Let's get started right after this. Hi, I'm Kim Ward. Welcome back to my channel. I am a certified probate real estate advisor and an expert at helping executors, administrators, and trustees with homes in probate or trust. We're going to talk about closing costs for sellers. Can you negotiate closing costs? So who pays those costs and when do they pay them? After buyers save for that new home purchase and they have their down payment, and getting approved for a loan, it's hard for buyers to accept that they have additional out-of-pocket costs, closing costs. As a seller, you also have closing costs. Although the buyers have the lion's share of the closing costs, typically 3% or so of the purchase price, compared with you, the seller, at about 1 to 2% of the purchase price, and knowing that all those closing costs and expenses must be paid up front before it's officially sold. So before we hand over the keys to the decedent's home to the new buyers, these are the expenses that you could expect to have. You will have a closing fee to the escrow company. You will have taxes on the property, including property taxes, and in San Diego, we have a transfer tax fee. You'll have a fee for transferring title to the new buyer. You'll also have homeowners association fees where you're paying that monthly fee. If there's a homeowners association, there will be a fee in order to complete all the documentation by the homeowners association company to transfer that to your buyer. Of course, any outstanding mortgages or liens on the decedent's property. You'll perhaps have a home warranty fee. Many buyers ask for that in their purchase agreements, and most of the time the sellers do agree to go ahead and pay that home warranty fee for the buyer. You may have a transaction coordinator fee. In the purchase agreement, you may have agreed to a Section 1 termite clearance, which would in many cases mean having the property fumigated, putting a tent over it, and also any termite damage that needs repaired in order to give the buyer a Section 1 termite clearance. And of course, real estate commissions. That's how I get paid to help you. And the buyer's agent gets paid to represent the buyer. While your 1 to 2% may not seem like much compared to what the buyers are going to be coughing up in order to purchase the property, all their closing costs plus their down payment, etc., keep in mind that the sellers typically pay the real estate commissions, both the buyers and the person representing the seller. And that's typically between 5% and 7% of the agreed upon purchase price. As a side note, when involved in a probate, there's going to be statutory fees. Now, these are not included in the actual sale of the property. You will not see that on your estimated seller proceeds document. But there are statutory fees, and that's how the attorney, your probate attorney, gets paid, and you, as the estate representative, you get paid statutory fees also. On top of that, there will be some court fees to be paid for the probate, as well as what's called the probate referee. They are the person hired to appraise the property as of the date of death, so that the courts and your attorney, and me as your real estate agent, know what the value as of the date of death was for the house that we would be selling. Those fees, again, are not included in your closing costs statement. So how do you estimate these closing costs? Whenever I have an initial consultation with an executor or an administrator, as well as a trustee, I always draft an estimated seller's proceeds document. It's important that you feel comfortable. That's what's important to me, by knowing upfront roughly what it will cost in order to sell your loved one's home. On top of that, once there is an offer that's been accepted, I will redraft that same estimated seller proceeds document so that you can see, based on the current offer that you're accepting after we've negotiated, what the closing costs would be. On top of that, when it's close to the time where we'll be closing the escrow, the escrow company will draft their own seller's settlement statement that I will review prior to having them send to you. I will be reviewing it for accuracy to make sure that there haven't been any other charges that you, as the seller, should not be paying. The biggest mistake I ever caught was around a $5,000 error that if I hadn't caught it by reviewing that settlement statement from the escrow company, then the seller, my client, would have had to pay that. That's why I think it's really important for me to review everything prior to having it sent to you for your review. And just so you know, that's a rare situation, but you know, we're human and people do make mistakes. So of course, a word to the wise, it's really important that once you receive those documents that you really go over them with a fine-tooth comb to make sure that there aren't any expenses that you didn't think you were supposed to be paying. And of course, errors do creep up, and it's important that we review everything because we wouldn't want any surprises on the big day, the closing day. Now, to just give you a little bit of information about the buyer's closing costs, this is what the buyer will be taking care of. Have a loan origination fee. Typically that's about 1% that the lender is charging them to get them a loan. They'll have a small fee for running their credit report. They'll have a fee for the underwriter to access and review that credit report and determine if they have credit worthiness. They will be paying for an appraisal on the home to guarantee their loan to their lenders. So to review, remember I talked about the probate referee appraisal? That will be your expense, but the buyer will need to have their own independent appraisal for their lender. That's usually around $500. The buyer, in most cases, will also be paying for a home inspection. That's another $500. And on top of that, if they choose to have additional inspections, such as the mainline sewer line looked at, that could be a couple of hundred dollars. More, they will be paying a fee to the title company to look for any liens, unearth any unknown liens, and make sure that there's clear title when they become the owners of the home. That title insurance protects the lender and the homeowner from claims against the property. They also will pay escrow fee. The escrow fee will be 50% seller and 50% buyer paid. They may have private mortgage insurance. If the buyer has less than 20% to put down as their deposit, they are most likely going to have private mortgage insurance or PMI, and there's a fee for getting that set up. Sometimes buyers want to have a lower interest rate and they can pay what's called discount points. I just had a client that wanted to get a flat 3% interest rate, but they weren't putting down a full 20%. So they paid 1 point of the $500,000 loan, or $5,000, in order to obtain that 3% interest rate that they so desired. So that's a bit of an overview about the seller's closing costs and the buyer's closing costs. I hope you found this of value. If you did, give me that thumbs up, please. Go ahead, subscribe to my channel and to be notified of my weekly videos, and you wouldn't want to miss any of them, go ahead and hit that bell button. If you'd like to speak with me directly, give me a call, 619-741-0111. I'd love to speak with you about your exact circumstances, or if I can help in any way, I'd love to do that too. Thank you for watching. See you next week.